There is another Old Testament person. This man became a sample. He became a model about what we're talking about. Turn with me to 1 Samuel chapter 24. I like to talk about David and the spirit of forgiveness that was upon the life of David. You know very well that in 1 Samuel, Saul began to pursue David. David did not do anything. The problem of David was that God gave him victory. God elevated David. God raised David, and Saul was bent on eliminating him. He pursued him. He wanted to take away his life. He wanted to destroy him. But something happened. Turn with me to 1 Samuel chapter 24. If you read 1 Samuel 24 verse 4. And the men of David said unto him, behold, the day which the Lord has said unto thee, behold, I will deliver thy enemy into thy hand, that thou may do to him as it shall seem good unto thee. Then David arose and cut off the skirt of Saul's robe. You know, somebody can even quote the Bible to you to support you in doing evil. It is a matter of whether you are interpreting what the Bible says, or you're reading your own meaning into the Bible. They said, David, God has brought out your bread. This man that is pursuing you, you now have an opportunity to retaliate. Look at, this is the day that God has made to you, that you deliver your enemy to your hand, that you will do to him as he pleases you. David arose and secretly cut off his skirt. When David did this, the Bible said it came to pass afterward that David's heart smote him. Thank God for a man like this. No wonder he was a man after God's heart. You see what he did? Saul was against him, yet only because he got his skirt, his conscience pricked him. He had a living conscience. There are people who are in the pulpit, they do abomination, yet their heart does not blame them. There are people who are in the pew, they commit all sorts of atrocities, yet they are not bothered by their heart, they are not bothered by their conscience. But that was not the situation in the life of David. David, and in verse 6, the Bible said, and he said unto his men, God forbid that I should do this thing unto my master. You see, he still called him my master. He didn't say that wicked man. He said, God forbid that I should do this thing unto my master, the Lord's anointed, to stretch forth my hand against him, seeing he is anointed of the Lord. David still called him my master. And listen, he didn't say that wicked man. He didn't say that man that must be eliminated. Thank God for that type of spirit. And if you read in verse 11, when he was addressing Saul, he said, moreover, my father, he still called him my father. Though you want to kill me, he still called my father. My father. See the skirt of thy robe in my hand. For in that I cut off the skirt of thy robe and killed thee not, know thou and see that there is neither evil nor transgression in my hand, and I have not sinned against thee. Yet thou hunteth my soul. And David began to speak to him. At a point, the Bible says that in verse 16, it came to pass, when David had made an end of speaking these words unto Saul, that Saul said, is this thy voice, my son David? And Saul lifted up his voice and wept. And he said to David, thou art more righteous than I, for thou hast rewarded me good, whereas I have rewarded thee evil. My prayer for you is that people against you will speak unto you what Saul spoke unto David. Let those people who are plotting against you because of your Christian reaction, let them say, you are more righteous than we are. When you do that, then your righteousness must have exceeded that of the Pharisees and scribes. And then you are prepared to go to heaven. I want to draw your attention to these things. Here was David. Here was Jesus. Here was Stephen. These people, somebody broke their heart. Somebody pursued them. Somebody wanted to eliminate them. But they had a forgiving heart. I want to draw your attention to some points. The message that you are hearing may not be the one that may be returned with a preacher's ovation. It may not be the one that is sweet. It may be bitter. But I know the queens. Do you know the queens? If you look at the bitterness of the queen, you may not swallow them, and that sickness may not go. But when you overlook the bitterness and swallow the queens, it will do you good. This is not one of the sweet messages. But when you accept the authentic, inerrant, infallible word of God, your life will be transformed, and you can have an assurance that you are going to go to heaven. Should I still forgive him? This person that has broken my heart, should I forgive him? This person that has messed me up, this person that has taken me to court, this my caretaker, this my tenant who took me to court, do you think I should ever forgive him? This landlord who took me to court, do you think I should ever forgive him? Let me make a point or some points. If you are not prepared to forgive everyone, you are not yet fit for heaven. If you are not prepared to forgive everyone, you are not yet fit for heaven. If you are not prepared to tolerate nonsense because of Christianity, you are not yet prepared for heaven. Jesus tolerated nonsense because of you. The apostles tolerated nonsense because of you. All these comments on the pulpit these days, they are not biblical. People who say, anybody who said I will not see progress, may he never see progress. Anybody who said I no go see better, better no go near him. Anybody who said I will die, now him go first to die. These things are carnal. It is the anointing of carnality. They are from the heart of Satan. A child of God who is dead, who is heaven conscious, cannot make that statement. Does it sound hard? Yes, it may seem, but it is the word of God. That is what God has spoken. If you are revenging past injuries, you are inviting future injuries. When one will not quarrel, two cannot quarrel. Grammatically and in terms of reality, there's nothing like he quarreled me. Pastor, as I was there, this man came and quarreled me. That is nonsensical nonsense. There's nothing like he quarreled me. For two persons to quarrel, two of them must agree. If one person refuses, two persons cannot quarrel. Yes. Quarrel is when you stand there, I stand here, I talk, you reply, you talk, I reply, and quarrel will issue. And let me tell you, my friend, as long as vengeance will seem sweet to you, self is not yet dead. And let me warn you, if you harbor injuries, you close God's ears. If you harbor injuries, you are closing the ears of God. And let me tell you, there are two relationships: horizontal relationship and vertical relationship. Horizontal relationship is your relationship with man, man-to-man relationship. While vertical relationship is your relationship with God. Do you know, your horizontal relationship can affect your vertical relationship. If you are not in peace with men, how can you be in peace with God? If you cannot live, look at you, imagine you, sister, you speak in tongue, filled with the Holy Spirit, yet you cannot live with a fellow sister in the same room for one month, 1 week without quarreling. Shame! Shame! You are a shame to Christianity. You are a shame to what you profess. You are not living like Christ. And may God deliver you today in the name of Jesus Christ. Listen. Thrice blessed is he who cannot remember the things he ought to forget about others. You are a blessed man, a blessed woman, if you cannot remember the things you ought to forget about others. And by the way, it is a lot better to pardon too much than to condemn too much. It is better to pardon too much than to condemn too much. A coward never forgives. Anybody who cannot forgive is a coward. Are you a coward? If you are a coward, then don't forgive. Only the brave know how to forgive. Only the brave knows how to forgive. Those who are in need of forgiveness ought to make it their first duty to forgive. If you know you are in need of forgiveness, you want God to forgive you, then you ought to make it your duty to forgive other people. Yes, you ought to forgive the penitent. Somebody might say, but preacher, he has not come to apologize. He has not come to beg for forgiveness. But listen, let me tell you something. We should forgive those who are penitent for their own sake. But we should forgive the impenitent for our own sake. Forgive those who come to you apologizing because they came to apologize. But for your own sake, forgive those who do not come. Some forgive their enemies, but not until they are hanged. Some people want their enemies to be hanged before they forgive them. You want them to die. Let me ask you, how do you feel when you hear that that person had an accident? How do you think? How do you feel when you hear that that person, that fire, engulfed his things? That fire raised his shade. What do you feel? You say, yes, that is very good. His wicked, he's now eating his wickedness. Yes, that is good. Yes, more trouble is coming upon him. Oh, and you come to the church. You sit down to clap hands and you say, we're going to heaven. Heaven, heaven, heaven. Heaven is not your father's plot. Heaven is not your father's plot. Yes, it's not your father's plot that you have a certificate of occupancy to. A plot you can always go. It's not that year that your father owned. Heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people. If you cannot forgive others, you are breaking a bridge over which you must pass. Because one day you must offend somebody else. If not somebody else, you must offend God. And let me tell you another thing that you ought to remember. To return evil for good is devilish. To return good for good is human. To return good for evil is godlike. Take it again. To return evil for good is devilish. To return good for good is human. But to return good for evil is godlike. If you have never forgiven an enemy, you have never tasted one of the most sublime enjoyments of life. Don't retaliate before you forgive. And let me tell you, God is interested. God is absolutely interested in this stuff. I have always said, and let me say it again for emphasis, I will not be surprised if preachers go to hell because they have not forgiven people for a lot of things that happen. A couple of years ago, somebody asked me a question. He said, preacher, please, is there any place in the Bible where we have holy enmity? Holy enmity. I said, what do you mean? He said, because since I see enmity among church leaders, enmity among church people, don't you think we should target a holy one since it is done by church people? Sin is sin, no matter who commits it. Listen, if you want God to bless you, if you want God to open the door for you, if you want to go to heaven, there are three persons you must forgive. Three persons you must forgive. Number one, forgive yourself. You know, people have taken poison because they've not forgiven themselves. People have gone into cover. They've gone into terrible situations because they refuse to forgive themselves. You are blaming yourself for that wrong choice you made in marriage. You're blaming yourself for that wrong choice you made in profession. You're blaming yourself for that wrong choice you made in joining that particular ministry. You're blaming yourself for that wrong choice you made in going to live there, in traveling to that place. But let me tell you, you cannot change your past. You cannot change your past. You can't change your past. But what decision you make today can affect the future. I tell you, forgive yourself. Forgive yourself and you're going to be free. Number two, forgive others. Yeah, thus says the Lord. Forgive others. Preacher, what do you mean? Yes, I mean what I'm saying. Forgive others. He has broken your heart, but thus says the Lord. Forgive him. Yes, he killed somebody in my compound. Yes, I know. But God says, forgive him. Another thing you must do, forgive God. Preacher, what do you mean? I say, forgive God. There are people who are annoyed with God. They said, God, God, you have not given me the fruit of the womb. You have not given me the fruit of the womb. God, no employment. God, my business is not progressing. I don't know. Because of what you're passing through in life. Because of what you're passing through in life, you're annoyed with God. You are very much annoyed with God. You say, I can never forgive God. Even the other day you said you were going to leave teaching in the Sunday school. You said you were not going to come to church. After all, the ones I've been coming, what's the need? Since my situation has not been changed. Do you come to God because of what he gives you? Or because of whom he is? Forgive God. You must clear your heart. Anything, any ought you have against God must be settled in this moment. In the name of Jesus Christ. It is when you open your heart unto God, when you say, God, I surrender. I surrender everything. I surrender my heart. I surrender everything. Lord, anything I have in my mind against myself, I want to forgive. Anything I have against others, I want to forgive. Any evil I have against you, Lord, I forgive. You are going to be a blessed man. And just before we begin to round up, there is a passage that I want to draw your attention to. In the Gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 11, verse 25. The Bible says, and when you stand praying, you know, I wonder how somebody can be a prayer warrior when there are people you have not forgiven. I wonder how you can stand and prophesy when there are people you have not forgiven. I wonder how you can live a happy life when there are people you have not forgiven. The Bible says, I say to you, when you stand praying, forgive. If you have aught against any, that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses. He said, when you stand lifting up your hands, you ought to forgive somebody. You ought to forgive anybody who sinned against you. You ought to forgive anybody who had broken your heart. You ought to forgive anybody who has committed any abomination against you. That is the word of God. It will allow the Spirit to flow. It will allow freedom in your heart. It will allow you freedom. It will allow the Spirit of God to take absolute control in your life. Hey, you can be sure that you are going to go to heaven. Not staying here and saying, well. And sometimes, somebody have something against may be free. You may have something against your pastor. You may have something against your boss. You may have something against your wife. And if you have not told the person, if the person might be moving freely while you are dying in silence. Today is a day of reconciliation. It's a day of standing on your feet, adding feet to your faith, moving to that person and embracing. Let me tell you something. The way you get forgiveness is not to come and judge. Bring somebody and say, all right, sit down here. Let me sit down here. And the person might begin to say, well, the other day you said this and I said the other one. The other day you did the other one and you did the other one. That is not the way. Arise and go to the person. It doesn't even end in only praying here. You have something, you have squandered somebody's money. And after preaching now, you raise up your hand and say, God, I'm sorry. It doesn't end there. Arise and go to the person. Say, my boss, I am sorry. I've offended you. Listen, even if you are the boss, you can get to that junior fellow and say, I am sorry. I faulted here. I faulted the other person. The Bible says, it is only in doing this that you may be the child of your Father who is in heaven. So find it difficult to say, I am sorry. I am sorry has sent many wives packing out of their husband's house. I am sorry has broken many homes because you find it difficult to say, I'm sorry. Whether the person is junior or senior to you, you can approach the person. You can say, I am sorry. That is the command of God, that you may be the child of your Father, which is in heaven. Are you preparing to go to heaven? Do you want to go to heaven? That is what matters. It's not whether you're going to church, hiding in your heart. So somebody must say, preacher, what are you saying? Imagine this man who has been spoiling my name, gossiping with my name from place to place. You know, right now, in every church, we have Sister Medium Wave Band and Brother FM. Sister Medium Wave Band and Brother FM. Go to his house. Go to her house. He is the director of current affairs of their church. He knows how to butcher people with tongue. He knows how to gossip. And somebody might say, preacher, what do I mean? What do you mean? This man gossiped with my name and I heard it. He gossiped with my name. I heard it. In fact, I heard it from three witnesses. What do I do? Don't I retaliate? Don't I take excuse from God and try to teach him a lesson? Listen, should I forgive him? Should I still forgive him? Should there be a medicum of forgiveness in my heart towards this person? Preacher, do you mean if I don't forgive him, I will not go to heaven? I say yes. Yes, the word of God says yes. If you don't forgive, you will not be a child of God. If you don't forgive, you cannot go to heaven. If you don't forgive, God will not forgive you. And if God does not forgive you, you will not go to heaven. It does not matter what he has done to you. It does not matter at all what he has done to you. There is a God in heaven who giveth the grace. He will give you the grace. He will give you the favor. My prayer for you is that you take your decision today. As you make a step to that person, as you go to the person, the Lord will give you favor. Said Hashem, hold me. How can I go to him? Don't hold. You can hold yourself into the grave if you begin to say, hold me. Forget about a hold. Yes, let it cost you something because of heaven. Not because the person feeds you. Not because the person gives you money. Not because the person is your God. But because God said, follow peace with all men. I like that verse. He said, pursue peace. That is what King James said. Pursue peace. Pursue it. If it is running away, pursue it. Pursue peace with all men. Pursue peace. If peace runs to any country, follow it until you get it. Get reconciled. God says, get reconciled. The Spirit of God says, you cannot be free except to reconcile with a person. Yes. He has stolen your money. God says, get reconciled with him. He has accused you falsely. God says, forgive him. He has given you marriage disappointment. God says, forgive him. He opposes you at the committee meeting. God says, forgive him. He slaps you. God says, forgive him. He ran away from your house. God says, forgive her. Hey, he had sex with another person. God says, forgive. 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 He refused to train you. Forgive. Forgive. I can hear the Spirit of God saying, forgive. God, it is difficult. Yes, it's difficult. He says, forgive. He does not compel us to go against our will, but he makes us willing. He makes us willing, and he will give the grace. It's difficult, but by the grace of God, by my spirit, not by mind, not by power, but by my spirit, by the Spirit of God, you can make it. Right where you are, you can bow your heads. I want you to bow your heads. The Spirit of God is here. It's not an easy road.
Dominion.
Oh, hallelujah.
Even when I go astray.
You have been going astray.
Dominion.
By bearing in your mind.
Even when I go astray.
Naturally speaking, you should not forget. People have even begun to say, do me or do you, God, no go face. hold on to the Lord. It is only when you forgive that your name go remain in the book of God. When you don't forgive, how can you draw nearer to God? The Spirit of God is talking to you. And I believe in my heart that through this message, God is trying to draw you nearer. Because you have been going astray in deciding not to forgive, in deciding to have more injuries in your heart. Oh, Holy Spirit. I want you to begin to talk to God. Even as you listen to this song. Say, Lord, look at this thing. Father, I need your grace. It's difficult to come. But I need your grace. Grace, 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 grace. This race you have started. This eternity. Unforgiving spirit can cause you hell. It does not matter how much you have, how much you are you. Unforgiveness can destroy things for you. Let me pray for you. Place your two hands on your heart. Our Father, we come to you. Oh God, give us the grace. Grace! Grace! As we step out of this place today, Father, to go for a reconciliation, to go to reconcile, I pray for your grace. I pray for your enablement. I pray for your power, Lord. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy. Give me the courage. Give us the courage to move on. Give us the courage to reconcile. Give us the courage to make peace. To the glory of your name. We want to go to heaven. We don't want to stop on the way. We don't want this thing to stop us from going to heaven. We don't want this thing to create a barrier between us and you. Father, thank you. Forgive us, Lord. Thank you for answering our prayers. We bless your name and we give you the glory. We praise you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus Christ, as you give this person special grace to do what you have spoken in your word today. Thank you, Lord, for answering our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God loves you. He wants you to go to heaven. Follow his word and it shall be well with you. Amen.